The next speaker is Mr. Sandeep Jain. He's Business Development Manager at ESI Group, Pacific Mindware Engineering Limited in Pune. Mr. Jain has done his MTech from Thermal Science and Fluid Mechanics at IIT Kanpur in 2000. He's more than 15 years of industrial experience and has worked in the past in ICM CFD analysis and consultant of General Motors and Ford Motor Company in Europe. Today, he's going to talk about a topic, emissions and fuel consumption trade-offs of turbocharged diesel engine equipped with electrically heated catalyst. Please start with your talk, Mr. Jain.
My topic for today is the trade-off between emission and fuel consumption for turbocharged diesel engine and is equipped with electrical heated catalyst. So the presentation overview, I will just give you very quickly ESI and Gamma Technology introduction, how we working together, and then case study introduction, which I'm going to talk about. Then I will touch about engine and vehicle model and subsystem of after treatment system model, and then some highlight on analysis and result, and at the end some conclusion remark. So just to tell about ESI, so we started in 1973, more than 40 years before, and it is founded by the expert of materials. And then Vishal mentioned yesterday that we are the first company done the crash test on Volkswagen Polo and how we started in the crash. And later on we add in virtual manufacturing, and then we added like portfolio of casting, sheet metal forming, welding. So that's gone, then we listed in the Euro exchange, and then we become a listed company in France. And later on we started with the expansion in different domain, NVH, durability, vibroacoustic, comfort, and started Indian operation that time. And then we add more and more countries, and then we add in the virtual reality and ICU2, immersive virtually, you can see the object directly in the virtual world. And ESI later on acquired OpenCFD, which is a open source CFD software, which is part of ESI group now. And later on, I think everyone know about that we are looking for a clouds, and that's where ESI last year, this start of this year, and acquire another company, C-Space, to done simulation in the cloud area. So if you see, ESI offer a like a complete solution from virtual manufacturing, virtual performance, and Vishal already talked about that, so I will just skip most of the part. So it can cover like most of things, and virtually you can see your solution. And then we provide end-to-end solution virtually. So everything you can do virtually, so you don't need to depend on very high paid testing, and time to the market can also be improved through these simulations. So ESI, we have an office in India, Pune and Bangalore, and we are more than 40 countries. And from Pune, basically we do in Gamma Technology business. This is a company in Chicago. So we are associated with them from last 10 years, and we providing training, support, and sales in India, and the development happen in their head office, Chicago. So just about GT Suite software, so GT Suite come with like a many precursor tool, GT Space Claim, Gen 3D, Cool 3D. So it is a different module we have. So basically you can import your 3D CAD geometry and then automatically convert to 1D, and you can even clean up your geometry in the precursor Space Claim. And we also providing like a converged light integrated in the GT Suite, so some simulation you want to do in 3D, and but it is a light version of Converge. So we have a this graphics window where you can set up the model, and GT also providing like a DOE and post-processing tool to run the complete setup in DOE mode. So I think it is giving a complete solution from CAD till the end solution. So GT Suite can solve like a very advanced solution. So if you see, this is a, like just a SEPSUP assembly, and it is a, like a completely integrated solution. So you can start with engine, add your ECU controller, add your after treatment system, valve train. You can add cooling. You can see like an orange driver to make him comfort. You can add your air conditioning, environment effect, complete drive cycle. So this complete you can do integration. So you can do one or two system integration, or like a complete solution. So GT provides this kind of a facility. So I will just give go for my case study introduction. So as we know, like emission is very challenge, and then we are a topic for energy and environment. So we know, like in Delhi also, we are facing like government is planning order even kind of things, and they stopped even registering diesel engine near NCR region. So it is like a very big challenge. So it is like a strange emission standard requirement. So there is one of the option is to cook catalyst light off. So one of the strategy we can consider to put a electrical heated catalyst upstream of main catalyst. So to improve your cook catalyst time off, to assess the effect of this electrical heated catalyst, we make a very integrated model which include like engine, your vehicle, and your after treatment system. So this is integration of engine, vehicle, and after treatment model. And on that, we evaluate this on the new European driving cycle with the to evaluate like what is the control strategy we have to apply on electrical heated catalyst. So this also published in 2012 at Powertrain SA conference in France, and later on Clear's workshop in US. So to give our view of modeling, our view, we have used 2-liter turbocharged diesel engine, and we use in this case European mid-cycle passenger car. So this can be applied to locomotive or any kind of engine size, and we done the simulation on the NEDC and FTP cycle to evaluate the effect of driver, and we built a multi-catalyst system including kinematic, and electrical heated catalyst is used to preheat the exhaust gases coming from engine to shorten the light off time for main catalyst DOC, and then improve the conversion efficiency. So that was the purpose of that. And the heater out getting for electric heated is from auxiliary torque put on the engine crank train for representing as alternator. So to control the vehicle side, we use like a pedal brake kind of a situation to inject fuel for the vehicle model. So this is like an integrated GT suit model where on the left side, this is just a sub assembly of a sub model of engine model on the left side, and then it is a linked with the after treatment model, and then it is mechanically connected to vehicle which controlled by the driver. It's just a overview of a integrated model we are going to use in this study. So I'm talking about this engine and vehicle model. So I think GT power give a like a very good advantage. It can be used like a very server level of engine model. So it can be start very detailed engine model, and then it can go to like a fast running model, and you can go to mean value model or even a map based. So based on the for this study, we have a detailed engine model, and we convert to fast running model, and it is to basically it will just combining the flow volume. So in that case, like 465 to 44, we divide combine the flow volume for fast running model. But the advantage of this is that it is still a dynamic model, and it can capture like in cylinder and combustion heat transfer in the fast running model to get same kind of accuracy of detailed model. So in this case, when we done this, we FRM model was 22 times faster compared to detailed model, and even still maintain the good accuracy. I will talk about this in next slide. And as mentioned, vehicle control by driver model with the pedal position, brake actuator, and then user speed, specified speed to be maintained. So this is the result for steady state result. For in the left side, we have airflow, and on the right side, fuel flow with the BMP. And it is run on the load sweep of 2,500 RPM. So this is a conversion of comparison of detail to FRM model. And what we find is there is a red line for detail engine, and then we have a blue line for FRM model. And you can see the error. So the throughout in that error is less than 2%. So we achieved the accuracy of fast running model within the 2% compared to detail model. And this is a non-steady state, so just to check on the transient run. So we try to do this is on transient run, and this is the plot for last 600 second of NED cycle. And basically you can see that FRM and detail model matching very nicely to each other top of it, and with the target vehicle speed. So the same for airflow and fuel. So still we achieve within the 2% accuracy. So this is like a vehicle control model. So we have a vehicle speed and then we have a target vehicle speed. So this is run for NEDC cycle. And then for this particular engine speed, so we are matching very nicely vehicle speed and target vehicle speed. So that means the vehicle model is working very nicely to control by the pedal position, clutch, brake, to get that kind of a scenario. So I think to do a very fair conversion, so we run as a baseline model for the model to see what is the status for the emission side. So fuel consumption was 5.9. So this is without heated catalyst as a baseline run. So and engine out CO, just after the engine out, we measure the emission so that we can compare what is the advantage we got from electrical heated catalyst. So I will talk about this after treatment system model now. So as you can see, like we have a diesel oxide catalyst. So before that, we put a electrical heated catalyst, and then we have a DPF afterwards, and then we have a urea injector before the SCR. And this is the below. We have a like a GT suit model for the different component. You can see electric heated, and then we have a DOC, DPF. So all the chemistry, everything is captured with the different templates available in the software. And so as I mentioned, like electric heated catalyst is powered by electromechanical system and connected to the crankshaft. And the size of the electric heated catalyst chosen from the paper based on Bissett and O in 1999. And we have a diesel oxide catalyst, coordinate square channel coated with platinum group metal, and then we have a diesel particle filter, symmetrical channel deep, well filtered with passive regeneration by anodic oxidation. And then we have a selective catalytic reduction with the geolite SCR square channel with the urea dosing system. So if you see, the electrical heated catalyst is validated with based on the paper Bissett in 1993. So this is shown for the FTP cycle for first 250 second. And so we have a result of like experiment heated. You can see the dotted line, and then in red dotted line, and then we have a experimental unheated as a red line. So GT is shown in the blue line, and then the paper published is shown in green line. So I think we have this temperature on the front metal side, and we have a ceramic on the rear of the catalyst. So heat is put it to this metallic and through 1150 watts, and then we have a on-off control strategy to threshold temperature 400. So if you can see, like the result of GT is very accurately matching with the experimental to show that model is working. So I will talk about the analysis and the result now. So I think it is very important to have a correct temperature to on electric heated. So we have a design of space is created for different threshold temperature and the heat input required. So if you see the dotted line, this is the like optimum. We need this much power for achieve this much temperature. Like we started from 400 to 525. So if you see the below line, like blue dots, so that means we are not able to achieve target threshold temperature. And potentially like above, this is like a potential waste of the heat, which we don't require. So optimum, we have to follow this dotted line. So the temperature is coming within the 3% of the target threshold temperature, which is like a very good. So in this one, we talk about the conversion efficiency, like for different temperature, threshold temperature, what is the conversion efficiency we are getting. And this is shown compared to threshold temperatures. So if you see like a 400 to 425, we are not getting very good advantage of conversion efficiency because that is not enough for DOC to heat up. And we can see like a 425 to 475 to 500, we are getting a very good conversion efficiency. So after that, like a DOC is already heated, so the conversion efficiency is not working. And the right side, we shown like a fuel penalty, like what is the fuel penalty in terms of conversion efficiency. So if you see, like we have to make a target like less than 4% of fuel penalty which give a very good conversion efficiency in our case. So I think beyond that, it is no advantage for us. So that is our limit, we can say. Okay. So I think we done this study on like 475 degrees centigrade, and the power required is 600 watt, and this is like a electrical heated valve temperature and DOC valve temperature shown with the heater on and off condition. So if you see like electrical heated valve temperature is reached within the 10 second for 75 Kelvin, and DOC for the 50% light off we reach in the 60 second. In like if it is heater is off, it is taking too long. So that is like give us the idea. So if you see the DOC conversion efficiency for the CO emission, you can see like when it is heater is on, we reaches 50 light off in 60 second. When heater is off, we reaches in 140 second. So if you see, we getting very good conversion efficiency with the heater is on condition compared to heater off. So this is shown like a SCR performance, and we taken as a temperature for user injector controller set to 215 degrees centigrade for this study, and ammonia and NOx ratio is controlled with 1%. So if you see, we have a urea heater on and heater off condition with temperature on and off. So I think if you see like injection start at 280 second when we have a heater on condition, and with heater off it take like 835. So I think you can convert too many NOx in very initial state itself when you have a electrical heated catalyst. So this is just to give a bar chart like what is the advantage we are getting with heater on and off. If you see like a CO emission, we 62, we convert like 50% improvement in hydrocarbon and CO emission, and NOx you can see more than 100% improvement we see. But same time we have a some fuel penalty also. To getting this conversion efficiency, we have a 3.2% of fuel consumption go up. So I think this penalty can be reduced like to re-optimize engine map, and in terms of injection timing, EGR, valve timing, and even adding WH, work waste heat recovery. He just shown us in the previous slide, like we can use like a waste heat recovery system also. And same time, maybe we can use a smaller DOC catalyst and even less PGM metal so that it reduced, overall reduced can be reduced for the system. So as we see, this is the like when we already have a cycle, so we just want to compare back to back NED cycles. So I think it is like start with cold and then followed by warm cycle. So after we just done the back to back comparison for two cycle in NEDC, so in this time we have a like the for second cycle we are getting more heated initially itself. So this is just to show wall temperature with heater on and off for two NEDC cycle, and then how CO and other things moving in the cumulative emission comparison. So I think we want to see like what is the effect on the, so in this case we have still improvement in CO and hydrocarbon and NOx, and but the fuel penalty reduced to 2.2. So initially we start with 3.2, but over the time it is the fuel penalty reduced to 2.2 for back to back NEDC. So this study done on the real world Jaguar Land Rover done the result, and then they put in the real world, and they shown for 2.2 liter diesel engine over FTP 75. So initially they have like 100% fuel consumption, and with this active heater catalyst they reached to 102% without transmission and engine calibration. With that one 103%. So it is same what we predict, like 2 to 3%. So this is in the real world, and this reference is shown in the paper they done in 2015. So at the end I will put some conclusion remark. So I think we studied like a 2 liter turbocharged diesel engine with European mid cycle, and then we build a after treatment system including electrical heated catalyst, and then we build a integrated model including engine, vehicle and after treatment system, and to study the optimized strategy to fuel consumption and emission trade-off. So as we've seen that threshold temperature of 475, we have a emission improvement of 50% for CO and hydrocarbon, and more than 100% for NOx, which is very good. But the corresponding fuel penalty was 3.2%. And then for back-to-back cycle, we reduced the fuel 2.2%. And then we've shown that this publication SI and Claire's presentation. And for real world also, we've seen the similar trend. So that's so good improvement. So some references is already available just to show, and some acknowledgement for the Gamma Technology team and PowerTech team. So thank you for your.
Thank you very much for your talk. Are there questions?
Please.
22.
It just increases
the temperature for DOC. So like your exhaust gas which is coming, so it is already heated up through each ESCs to DOC. So the time reach for light off. So it will, the DOC is the only object which reducing the emission. It is just to heat it up, the catalyst. Yeah, that's right.
And the DOC, what are the temperatures?
Sorry?
What about DOC?
DOC, you will get the higher temperature exhaust gas in DOC so that you can convert more emission faster. So that we shown in the result. DOC temperature. Yes. Yes. Yes.
So DOC doesn't absorb any of those?
Yes, DOC will convert this oxidation you put, and then it will convert.
So DOC is a diesel oxidation catalyst, so it will oxidize the CO and hydrocarbon.
So SCR, yeah. SCR is mainly for NO. Yeah.
So is it better to put DOC before DPF or after DPF?
Before DPF.
How is it better?
DPF is a particular filter, like the bigger particle is filtering that one. So firstly it convert in DOC. So always optimum to put DOC before DPF.
So, seemingly there are no questions anymore. Let's thank the speaker and all the ones who contributed very much.
Thanks.